Hi, today we will be discussing about invasive species as a threat to biodiversity. Human beings were responsible for causing lot of spread in species, geographical spread of species, and it is so much so that they have obscured the geographical barriers, and lot of, if you see, lot of species have been spread throughout the world. And the species which has been spread throughout the world, it reaches to a new environment, and in that new environment there is a possibility that the species may establish or it may not. So there are meager chances, but at a certain percentage of species get established in the new environment. Why it is not existing? Why it is not establishing in a new environment? Certain species are not existing. Why? Because the resources may not be suitable. It may be not sufficient, and also the environmental condition may not be suitable for the species. So in certain cases, in other cases, what happened? This species will be surviving in a new environment, because in that case what happened? These species will be having certain adaptation features, and it will start establishing itself and it will start multiplying, and this will lead to what? Invasiveness. These species are called as invasive species, and these established species in a new environment, they are established and they start multiplying, and in that way what happened? It will affect the native species also. I would like to quote Charles Elton's observation on invasive species. He said, I quote here, "We must make no mistake, we are seeing one of the great historical convulsions in world's fauna and flora." Charles Elton. He was knowing the magnitude of the problem with regard to the invasive species, and also E.O. Wilson's observations also in the same line. He also said the invasive species will cause more extinction than ordinary pollution. There are a lot of threats to biodiversity. One threat is invasive species, and this threat will cause definitely extinction that when you compare with the other threats, said E.O. Wilson. What exactly the invasive species are? Invasive species are the introduced species that increase in abundance at the cost of native species. They are having a power to displace the native species. They can prey upon the native species also. That will lead to extinction of the species. And these invasive species can alter the habitat in such a way that the native species cannot thrive anymore. And this is very, very important threat to biodiversity. And we look at the population dynamics of an invasive species. I say that the introduced species will try to establish in an environment, new environment, and wherein it will start adapting itself, and it will start utilizing the resources, and it will adapt, and so much so that it can, the population will be increasing. But this is not very quickly, it will take period. So the first and foremost period is in the population dynamics, when you look at it, it is the lag phase. Because the invasive species will take lot of time to establish itself, and that is called as lag phase, wherein the population will not be increasing higher. So that stage is called as lag phase, and thereafter, after some time, this species, invasive species, the number, the population, the species distribution, that will increase, and that is called as log phase. I would like to stress one important point, that along with the lag phase, there are certain other factors, environmental conditions, and the genetic changes also in the founder species. So all will be responsible for that lag phase, wherein the population of invasive species is lesser. But in case of a log phase, the population of an invasive species exponentially rises, and that leads to what? It will be causing lot of harm to the native species. And we'll talk about the why that species turns to be invasive, why it is. There are many species, but why certain species are turning itself into invasive? The first and foremost reason is the absence of native predators and parasites. In the natural habitat, of the exotic species, they would have got the native predators also, parasites also. But when they are introduced to a new environment, there is no native predators, there is no parasites. So in the absence of native predators and parasites, the species will thrive and will become more of invasive. And second reason is the human altered environment. The human beings also responsible for altering the environmental conditions. For example, the global climate change. This also alters the environment. So, because of the altered environment, what happened? These conditions are quite favorable for the exotic species to thrive. See, the human altered environment, it can be the habitat fragmentation, degradation, the high fertility, soil fertility condition or low soil fertility condition, light availability. There are so many factors, so many factors that will be responsible for making the exotic species to establish and thrive. And this human altered environment, we have to take it very carefully, because this can have an impact over the exotic species also, native species also. And this, because of this human altered environment, not only the exotic species, the population will be increasing. There are certain incidents wherein the native species also will thriving and the population will be increasing. For example, in case of the Gulf of Florida, what happened? The jellyfish. So, it start thriving there on oil rigs, artificial reefs, wherein because of that artificial reefs it started spawning, and there is availability of nitrogen because of the eutrophication condition or pollution condition. Because of the nitrogen pollution, the plankton population increased. So, what happened? This jellyfish was thriving on the planktons, and this interaction relation, this led to what? More of jellyfish population. And that is why, because of the human altered environment. So, the human altered environment can have an impact over the exotic species and also the native species. And next important factor as far as the species which is making, which the character which is making the species invasive, that is the flexible behavior of the certain species. They are very flexible, they can thrive in the new environment, they have their own, you know, sexual robustness, they quickly breed, and they can thrive in even extreme conditions, extreme environmental conditions. So, this flexibility helps the species to be invasive. And so, certain species are there which are very close to the native species. That means that the exotic species are related to the native species. In that case, what happened? Both the native species and exotic species will start mating or hybridizing. So, in that case, what happened? The species boundaries will be obscured. A new species, unique genotype will be evolved, and because of that thing, the species boundaries will be obscured. There will not be any geographical boundary. For example, the native Apache trout, that was a very important fish, and that was thriving in the western part of North America, that mated with an introduced sport fish. So, because of that thing, what happened? A unique genotype developed. That unique genotype, what happened? Because of that development, what happened? The species boundary was completely removed. And what are the means of species introduction? What are the means for species introduction? Why it is introduced? What are the reason? The first and foremost reason is the colonialism. So, colonialism is a very, very important reason. Because of that thing, species have been introduced everywhere. So, any colonial power, for example, you can say European powers. This European power, when they are going to a new environment, a new country, what happened in the process of colonialism, what they will try to introduce new species, birds, mammals, fish population. For what? For their own benefit. They will be for game purpose, for consumption purpose, they will be using fish population. And also what? In their countryside also, they will be having a same kind of environment, same kind of feeling, as if that they are living in the European condition. So, what happened? This is a very important reason. So, these European colonial powers, they have introduced many species of fish, mammals, birds, and to where? To North America, South America, Australia, New Zealand. So, everywhere, wherever they were colonial, they were colonialism, wherever they were going for this colonialism, they go for introducing the species. And second important reason as far as the introduction is concerned, their agriculture purpose. So, in case of agriculture and aquaculture, the most important thing is that the species are being introduced for as a crop, as an agriculture crop. If you see, for example, 99% of USA, the crops grown in USA are introduced. And in case of New Zealand, if you see, the number of introduced species is almost equivalent to the number of native species. So, as a crop, also these species have been introduced to every place. So, that is a very, very important thing. And as far as the ornamental crops are concerned, in India itself, you will see Icornia crassipus. It has been introduced as an ornamental crop. And there are many other plants. Icornia crassipus is a very important thing. And Lantana camara, that is another important ornamental plant that has been introduced in our country. and that has turned to a very invasive weed, and it is very, very problematic in fact. And another example is the purple loosestrife. This is also a plant, it has been introduced for ornamental purpose. And as far as aquaculture is concerned, believe me, there are so many fish have been introduced, whether in the freshwater environment or the estuarine environment, it has been introduced. And wherein what happened, these species, introduced species, will try to transform itself to be an invasive species. And another reason, as far as this the species introduction is concerned, is accidental transport. For example, weed species. In India itself, the Parthenium stereophorus was introduced along with the wheat seeds, wheat grains. So the weed, as a important species, it has been introduced along with the croplands. It's a very, very important thing, and it's very difficult for a weed species to be separated from a crop. That is kind of, you know, weed will mimic the croplands. That is a very important thing as far as weed species introduction is concerned. It is very difficult to manage also. For example, Parthenium stereophorus, it's very difficult to manage in our country. Next example is the pathogens, parasites, insects. When I talk about the pathogens, there are many pathogens that has been introduced along with the plant parts as far as the reproductive material, vegetative material is concerned. For example, in case of potato, late blight of potato, that has been caused by a fungus, that is Phytophthora infestans. Phytophthora infestans causes late blight of potato. And another crop that has been introduced from South America to Europe, which one? That is late blight of potato, caused by Phytophthora infestans. Another important disease, that is the mildew disease of grapes, that has been also introduced from USA to Europe. So there are many diseases. Hansenula nigata, the organism is Hansenula nigata. So what I want to say is that the pathogen, there are many pathogens along with the breeding material, along with the reproductive material, along with the plant parts, it has been moving from one place to another. That is also responsible for the introduction of a species, new species. And as far as insects is concerned, many species are there. Sanjo scale, Chondra speediotus, and happy woolly aphid. So there are so many species that has been introduced along with the crop plants, along with the plant parts. So this is also a very important thing as far as the insects is concerned. There are many insects, and for this quarantine is very, very essential. And as far as the examples are concerned, European honeybee, Apis mellifera, European bumblebees, Bombus terrestris, this has been introduced for a basic purpose, because this has been introduced for economic purpose. Intentionally it has been introduced. The fire ants, gypsy moth, Africanized honeybee, this has been introduced not intentionally, accidentally it was introduced. Another species, that is European earthworm, this has been introduced. It is causing lot of change in the soil ecosystem in the North America, and the biota that will be affected because of the earthworm. It's kind of change, because they are the ecosystem engineers, they can bring in a lot of changes in the soil properties. So this European earthworm that is causing lot of changes in the soil ecosystem in North America. And one more important thing is the ballast water. Along with the ballast water, the species also introduced to a new place. And as far as ballast water is concerned, there are many species I can say. One important example I would like to say is that is a zebra mussel. It has been originated in Caspian Sea. This, because it has been in the water, what happened? This European containers, say along with the ship it went, and it went, this ballast water was delodged. It was in Lake Erie. In Lake Erie, what happened in the Great Lakes of North America, this in Lake Erie, what happened, this zebra mussel that was introduced. And believe me, within so short a span of time, it started existing, and it started so much using the local condition, and it adapted itself also. And in what way? It has caused lot of harm to the native mussel. So that is the key thing as far as the introduction, accidental transport and introduction is concerned. Next example is the biological control. When I say biological control, as I told you, that these invasive species are introduced to a new environment. So there is a possibility that in the natural habitat of the exotic species, there may be a predator, there may be a parasite. So this predator or parasite can be used as a biological control. So in that we can have a better control. Certain incidences, what happened, this biological control also, instead of affecting the target species, it starts affecting other non-target species. The best example is the parasitic fly species, Compsilura concinnata. This was active against the invasive gypsy moth. But what happened, in addition, it started affecting more number of the gypsy moth species. So what I want to say is that this biological control is a very, very important tool for management, but at the same time care must be taken. Why? Because this also is a mean for species introduction. Very important ecosystem is the island ecosystem. So when I was talking about the species, the geographical spread of species, and it has been introduced everywhere, but this island ecosystem is very, very unique, because the species which has been introduced in an island ecosystem turns to be an invasive species, and that can lead to extinction of the species. There are certain reasons. First important reason is the island habitat. That is very unique. It has been isolated. Since it has been isolated, what happened? An endemic species will be evolving. And these endemic species, due to some genetic reasons, they are very, very vulnerable to any exotic species. And because of this vulnerability, what happened? The endemic species will be extinct sooner or later. And this, see, this native species present in the island habitats, they have limited defenses. When I say limited defenses, because the native or endemic species in the island habitat, if you see, they have a minimum number of predators, minimum number of parasites. So, because of that natural condition, what happened? They have a limited defenses. Since they have a limited defenses, they are very easily attacked by the native, exotic species. And also another important factor is these native species that is thriving in an island habitat, they lack natural immunities, because they don't have the natural immunities to immunities against what? The diseases, the pathogens that is present in the mainland. So since they lack natural immunities, what happened? This exotic species, if they turn to an invasive species, they can easily attack the native species of an islands. For example, the brown tree snake, Boiga irregularis, in Pacific Islands. This has been introduced in the Pacific Islands. There are, you know, believe me, this brown tree snake, what happened? It has caused a lot of devastation. This snake, it's just dangerous. Why? It started taking a lot of eggs, bird eggs, nestlings, adult birds. It started feeding. So it leads to the extinction of many species in the Pacific Islands, mainly the Guam Islands, wherein 7 out of 11 species was extinct because of this brown tree snake. This shows the vulnerability of the native species in an island ecosystem. And as far as the aquatic habitats are concerned, I said fish species have been introduced for many purposes, intentionally or unintentionally. When I say intentionally, it means that the fish population has been introduced to increase the fisheries, to increase the fish production. When I say unintentionally, through the ballast water it can be introduced, or many other, accidentally also it can be introduced. So this fish, if you see the worldwide, if you see, there are more than 120 fish species have been introduced. It's a very, very important organism, if you say that 120 species have been introduced. And for example, if you see the tilapia species and Nile perch that has been introduced into Lake Victoria, that is in Africa. So that is the best example as far as the aquatic habitat is concerned. And I was just talked about the zebra mussel in Great Lakes, how it was introduced from Caspian Sea along with the ballast water, and that has caused a lot of extirpation of the local or native mussel population. And next example, as far as the invasive species in aquatic habitat is concerned, aquarium and ornamental species, this is very responsible because it's having a lot of trade also. For example, the invasive alga, Cholerpa taxifolia, this is a very important example as far as the aquarium and ornamental species are concerned. And this invasive species have, you know, influence on the pathway, evolutionary pathway of the native species. The first and foremost point to be discussed is the mixing of biota. See, way back this Red Sea and Mediterranean Sea, it has been separated. In fact, now it has been separated for long millions of years. So what happened? The biota in that, either in the Red Sea or Mediterranean Sea, were different. And this has been removed. Why? Because of a Suez Canal was constructed way back in 1869. Because of the construction of Suez Canal, what happened? The species from the Red Sea entered into Mediterranean Sea, or species from Mediterranean Sea entered into Red Sea. There was a mixing of biota. So this red species, what happened? Many species entered into Mediterranean Sea, and there was a niche displacement. So Mediterranean Sea, the fish population, they were thriving very happily. They were thriving, but what happened? Their foraging habit, that they were displaced to the lower depths. This Red Sea species, when they entered into the Mediterranean Sea, what happened? They started to survive in the upper part, the warm waters, surface waters. They were thriving much better. So what happened? There was a niche displacement that was there because of this biota mixing was there. And also there are two important species that is, tremendous. The population of the Red Sea species was tremendously increased. Why? Because the nocturnal feeding habit, because the species that was thriving in the Mediterranean Sea, they don't have the nocturnal feeding habit. But the species from Red Sea, they had nocturnal feeding habit. Because of this nocturnal feeding habit, what happened? The resources was quite efficiently utilized by the species. And because of that thing, what happened? The population of that particular species, the nocturnal species, that was increased. Next example, as far as the mixing of biota is concerned, the great American interchange of biota, because of the formation of isthmus in the late Pliocene period, what happened? The isthmus, that is, Central America, you will be finding it. So because of the isthmus, what happened? The species from the North America moved towards the South America, and from South America moved towards the North America. And if you see this evolution, there is a lot of evolution in response to the invasive species also that is taking place, not only in invasive species, and also it is taking place in the native species also. Evolution is taking place because of the impact of the invasive species. For example, 5 species of host specific moths evolved as a result of banana introduction in Hawaii. Hawaii is a small island, it's a Pacific island. So in that, because of the introduction of banana crop, 5 species of host specific moths evolved. It's a very, very important thing. So this is an example for an evolution in response to an invasive species. And I told you about the weed plants. The weed plants also evolve in response to human action. The best example is Echinoclova crescalli. That is an important weed in case of paddy crop, because these both Echinoclova crescalli and the Oryza sativa, they are very mimic, they were almost similar. So, it's very difficult to segregate them in the production after harvesting. It's very difficult to segregate them. That can cause a lot of the spread of the species. And next important thing, as far as the evolutionary pathway of native species is concerned, hybridization and introgression is also a very, very important thing. When I say hybridization and introgression, the best example I'll say, through this example I'll explain to you, Spartina alternifolia, it is an introduced species. And this hybridized with the native species Spartina maritima. So this both hybridized, and because of this hybridization, the product, the offspring was a sterile hybrid. It was unique, it was sterile hybrid. Because of the chromosome doubling, the sterile hybrid can converted into the fertile one, that is Spartina anglica. So this, look at it, how the species have been evolving. There are many examples in case of sunflower also. So what I want to say is that hybridization and introgression is also a very, very important pathway, evolutionary pathway. And next is niche displacement. Example is the gray squirrel from North America. It displaced the native red squirrel of Britain, and it is completely displaced. This is called as niche displacement. Why it was displaced? It was displaced because for the competition for food. Because of the competition for food between the species, it has displaced the species. This is called as niche displacement. Next is the competitive exclusion. The best example is the Argentine ant displaced the native ants throughout its native. Wherever it has been introduced, it started displacing the native range, the native ants. Why? Because this Argentine ant was best competitor for food resource. It is having the resource use efficiency, so it competes very well for the food resource. Because of this competition, it can exclude the native species. This is called as competitive exclusion. One important thing as far as the evolutionary pathway of native species are concerned, extinction is a very, very important thing, because this invasive species, I told you earlier, that can lead to extinction. It can be a local, it can be regional, it can be a global extinction, it can be a functional extinction. Extinction is possible. The best example is the invasive brown tree snake. I told just now, that is, the scientific name is Boiga irregularis, that has caused extinction of many species in Guam Island. Next example is the Nile perch. that was introduced into Lake Victoria in Africa, that has led to, you know, extinction of hundreds of cichlid fish species. So many species have been extinct because of this introduction, Nile perch introduction. And next example is the zebra mussel. I told you many times that how this species, zebra mussel, when it was introduced in Great Lakes, that is the Lake Erie, in that it was introduced, what happened? Because of the adaptive, local adaptation condition, this zebra mussel thrived very well and it extirpated the local native mussel. It's extirpation. So this is also an extinction. To sum it up, this invasive species is a very, very important threat to biodiversity. When you compare this invasive species with other threats, I can say that this is a foremost important threat, because this invasive species, when it enters, the introduced species, when it enters into a new environment, it starts multiplying, it starts integrating into the system, new system, and when it is integrated into the system, it's very difficult to separate it, it's very difficult to control it. It's been so well integrated, and in that case what happened, it's very difficult to control also. The cost is also a very important factor, because the cost involved in controlling the invasive species will be more. When you compare with other threats, the habitat fragmentation, degradation, in many cases pollution also, there are many threats are there. In that case you can rectify it, provided you have the original species. If it is there, we can rectify the habitat fragmentation, you can rectify it. But in case of invasive species, once for all, the original or native species will be driven to extinction. It's a very, very difficult condition. So that is the reason why I can say that very categorically, the invasive species is a very important threat to biodiversity. We need to manage it. How? So we can manage it by adopting certain public education programs. Through this public education program, we can bring in awareness among the citizens. We can teach the population, people, about the nitty-gritties of controlling an invasive species, about the invasive nature of a species, about how dangerous, how it can cause an impact, severe impact on a local population. So this public education program is a very, very important thing. Along with this public education program, there is need for training the citizens and training the staffs involved in protected areas, because those staffs will be knowing exactly which region is vulnerable, which habitat is vulnerable. So they can monitor very well the invasive species. Once they can monitor, their control will be very, very possible. And not only that thing, because this, when they monitor the invasive species, they can have a better control, because in a very quicker possible time, they can control with least cost also. So the public education along with training the citizens and the staffs involved in protected area management is a critical component in managing this invasive species. And next one is the adoption of biological control. I told you that this biological control is having certain drawbacks, but still this biological control has to be taken into account seriously and sincerely. When I say biological control, I told you that in the exotic species in its habitat, what happened? It will have its own predators, it will have its own pathogens, it will have its own parasites. So these, because of the checks and balances that has existed in the exotic habitat, what happened? The species is under control. But when this exotic species, if it has been introduced into a new environment, because of the absence of the predators, what happened? This species start multiplying, start establishing itself, and it increases in abundance at the cost of native species. So we need to use this natural mechanism by using the predators that is present in the exotic habitat, we can have a control over the invasive species. So that's the best possible method. But at the same time, we need to monitor once it has been introduced, biological control has been introduced into an environment, we need to monitor over what, how effective it is. Second is, we need to monitor for its host specificity. It should not affect the other species other than the target species, or in other words, non-target species should not be affected by the biological control. And next as far as the management is concerned, this invasive species can be managed by physical control, by poisoning, because this, somehow this invasive species has to be controlled by many methods, physical methods also. And also one method is there, the land use practices. When you change the land use practices, so when you change the land use practices, what happened? Because human beings will be changing the land use practices, because of the changing the land use practices, what happened? These species, the invasive species will be unable to thrive in the environment. So by that way, what happened? This invasive species can be controlled very well, because when you group this invasive species, there are certain species, for example, the weed species, that will be thriving only in the energy rich environment or nutrient rich environment. So under that condition, in the absence of the nutrient rich environment, this weeds will not be surviving. But there are certain other species, invasive species, where which will be thriving in a resource poor environment also. But what happened, these invasive species will try to have an association with the mutually beneficial microorganisms. So in that way, what happened, these both invasive species and the mutual microorganisms will be together, manage and thrive in the extreme environmental conditions. Thank you.